What's up, everyone? It's Coach Johnson, and in today's video, we have submitted videos via Instagram, and we are going to do some video analysis that you guys submitted. So, want to see if you're included in today's video? Check it out. Before I really get into the main intro, I want to let you know, I'm going to break this down a little different. When you ever order a video analysis from us, we go into big depth. I do comparisons and we do multiple camera angles, and it's a very in-depth, thorough thing. What we're going to do now is what we always kind of refer to as our group analysis. It's going to be some high level key things, point out some of those kind of core things, tie it to the chain reaction. That's just how we look at everything and do everything. And hopefully that gives you some clarity on your throw. So you guys are submitting videos, just understand this is just designed to give you some insights, have everybody who's watching other people learn. Maybe you don't see your video done, but you'll see somebody who's throwing very similar to you and you'll learn from that. And that's the idea. So we also want to help coaches kind of see how, you know, maybe look at the throw with a different lens. And that's the whole idea. So we're going to dive in now. Hopefully you find it helpful. So we'll see you on the videos. I want to say thanks to everybody who submitted video. We're going to try to do this kind of weekly. It's off season. We're going to be shifting gears. It's really important to be working on the right things, obviously, so that we get the best out of the upcoming year. We just kind of chose people who were quick on the draw and shot video in. Now, thanks to everybody who submitted, we had a ton, and I mean a ton. So there's going to be a lot of cool things coming, and we'll be sharing some of those. And a lot of you guys are doing a great job. So most of the people who submitted were doing a lot of really good things, and that's great to see. Okay, so first up is Colton Burr. He's been following our channel for the last 4 years, and he finds it helpful, and I appreciate that, the compliments. And so we're going to take a look at a couple things. I think he's doing a lot of good things. Let's look at his throw in full speed real quick, and you'll kind of see, not bad. He's throwing right around, it seems like about right around 50 feet. So here we go. So when we look, what you're going to see, a couple of things. The general movement isn't bad, but you're going to notice that a couple things is he's got a bit of a narrow sweep. Okay, so that is going to cause him to come in here. He's got the active arm, but you're going to notice the left arm path isn't bad, but you're going to notice that he kind of sits. Okay, so Colton, you're kind of sitting down. So what that's going to do now is that's going to cause a little bit of a stretch, right? He's going to step to the middle instead of rotating faster to the middle. And so again, these are some of the things we talk about, how we set up in our throwing chain reaction system, our pillar 1, 2, and this is pillar 3. What he's doing in 3 is, as he's coming here and he's rewrapping, everything's pretty good, but you're going to notice, like, here's the center of the circle. If you looked at somebody like Ryan Krauser, who's 6'7", he probably lands with his foot somewhere around here. I'm not imagining that you're, you know, 6'5". Where I'm going with this is, as he comes around in the little bit of the sit, which is going to slow down speed this way, so he's going to try to have to accelerate. He does a nice job of kind of trying to transition here. This is what we call, again, pillar 4, where we're going to transition from his sprint leg to his delivery leg, and he's going to wrap up, right? We're going to try to increase speed at this point. And so what you see is his angle is a little too much here, right? He needs to get the angle where it's a little bit more here, okay? So the angle, the angle would probably look more like this on the conversion. So what you're going to do is be able to rotate faster on top of the axis. And so hopefully you can kind of see what I'm talking about. So he does this and he pulls this the rewrap in. You see how it kind of comes to close to the body? So this is kind of consistent with what you're seeing with this kind of angle. It's a little too severe, like I said. So if we landed more here in the center, and he would look, his angle should look a little bit more like this. He's got to get to this point where he's to the more of the center. And again, notice the key thing that we're talking about here is it's got to be a wider sweep in the start, because he's sitting down and now it's creating too much of a reach and this angle. And so what you see here is, as he comes into the throw, there's a little bit of a shift, right? Because this angle always has to straighten up into delivery. It's going to straighten up, not completely, but it's going to be moving around into the throw. Now, again, I want to point out, like I said in the beginning, good movement. I think there's a lot of really good things going on. So Colton, good work to you and your coach. But you're going to notice at this point, because he's going to shift, this arm is going to open a little too much, and then he's going to pull, and then he's trying to block. But you notice at this point, block foot's off the ground. And so Colton is getting a little bit of a shift, and pull around, and again, block foot's off the ground. So now he can't drive and create as much speed and force through the delivery. So at this point, when you see when that block foot comes off first, you're gonna notice with most elite world-class throwers, they're always gonna keep that block foot on the ground because they're driving into it. You gotta stay on the ground, especially if you're you want to drive through it and time it, but with that block leg coming up, that now the ball is going to be pushing back as you're pushing against it. So this is just something to think about. So as you guys look at your video, if you see your block leg coming off the ground first, there's going to be reasons. Now again, notice we looked, I'm presenting things in terms of a chain reaction. You're seeing how I'm looking at the throw from, like I said, pillar 1, 2, 3, 4, and now we're seeing what the effects of those earlier stages of throw due to the pillar 5, 6. So hopefully some of this just gives you some extra insights. And again, what I think with you and your coaches are doing good work, but these are just some insights that we see. All right, next up we have Kylie Kranz. She submitted, she's a glider. Now, one thing I'd recommend for gliders when you send in, you can see the linear line great on the glide from this angle. So I do like to see this angle, but you're gonna really see the glide unfold a lot more technically from the side angle. There's so many key things and positions that you really need to be able to see it from the side. So we're gonna still get some good info here, but it's a little harder to see. So here we go. So we're gonna play again Kylie's throw in full speed. Again, she loads up. I like the movement. And you can kind of see that she's got a pretty good strike, but there's no reverse. And I find this to be a common thing. And you want the reverse to be, even if it's a non-reverse, there's still gonna be some element of follow through. One of the things that we'll talk about is creating a little bit of separation so you get those shoulders turned just a touch. And you're gonna notice that when she comes down, this would be really close to what we would say in our system, right? With a glide, we're gonna create a setup in our pillar one. We're gonna load and coil, drop and slide. These are progressions in the linear throw. And so when she comes, she kind of comes up, she kind of comes, right? She's coming down. So this is what we teach, similar. Again, there's a different sequence, but what she's doing here is pretty good. So she gets a pretty good punch across the circle. I like that. So she drives off the heel. Now right here though, you're gonna notice that the hips are a little back and she's driving that foot in. And now when she tries to open it, it's creating a little bit of a hip shift. And so when you see that hip shift, now the hips are moving off, the ball's moving closer to the delivery leg. And what's it gonna do? She's gonna get this block arm opening, right? It's not bad, but you see how it kind of opens? That's opening more like a rotational thrower. And what we want to see is the arm kind of open here. So again, if we looked at Valerie Adams or Michelle Carter or Gong of China, right? You would see the arm kind of open in this. And we call that a T. So she's got a pretty nice position here. And what we call is the glide T. So when we see the elbow to elbow and then kind of the spine position. And again, we're looking at that side angle, we'd see it a little bit better. What you're going to see is as she comes around, see how it's kind of here. This looks more like a rotational finish. When you're trying to glide, you're not going to be able to keep the shot and punch it as hard, but it's a nice position. But see, she's got the block leg down, this foot's coming off, but at this point she doesn't push drive through, and you see how the block arm now comes past her body and the shot just came, you know, out of her hand. So if you look here though, here's where better position, you can see that the block arm is now past the body. So she's got the shoulders here, the hips are squared. So right, we can see how the hips are kind of here, and then the upper body is here. And what we need to do is have the hip through, and so that we have the upper body coming in. So you can see the upper body's a little ahead, and that's gonna reduce some of the punch and why some of the follow through. You can see here, she's not gonna be able to really get the hips all the way through. It's not a bad throw. Again, there's a lot of good stuff, but sometimes this can be a lot of to do with strength levels. And so again, just going back real quick, you'll see that little shift. This comes up a little late. I would wanna see the arm opening here, so she's gonna see a little bit more of that traditional kind of pull down with the block. Here you're gonna see the shot come off, and it kind of is more coming out like a rotator. You see that? Whereas a linear shot, you're kind of coming this way a little bit more in the glide. I would say one of the key things you want to do is you're going to work just lightly on that block arm or whatever. But again, I would assume you have some coaching because you're moving really well. So different lens for you and your coach to kind of see some things through. Hopefully that's good. Shoot us a message and let us know how things go if that was helpful. All right, good work. Next up, we have Claire. Claire's a discus thrower, clearly, and you're going to see what we're looking at One thing, the setup, see how she's a little low? So one of the things we always try to tell people with the discus, the orbit, separation, stretch, reflex, these are all the things that we're setting up. You hear us talk about our throwing chain reaction system and our six pillars. We're gonna focus on specific things here in pillar one. There's just a couple of things. When we set up the position, notice how the discus kind of comes down, right? So it's a subtle thing, but the discus is kind of coming down and then around. And what we wanna do is have more of a gradual wind, right? So it's like one of those little tops that you turn and spin. And what you would wanna do is you wouldn't wanna be trying to turn it like this. And there's a little bit of an orbit issue. And so she does a nice job though of creating separation. And as she turns, but you see how she's low. So it's not uncommon for a lot of elite women throwers to kind of have a little bit more of an up down motion than you see with men's throwers, but she's a little too low. And then the thing that we notice here is she's doing a nice job of getting this foot turned around, but we're seeing what it looks like, in my opinion, is that the shoulder and the arm are kind of opening a little too much together. You see that? So see how the arm's way open over here now? So now you could get away with that to a certain degree in the shot, but in the discus, right, you got to create the length to pull yourself into the circle. So what we would call, again, our pillar one, our pillar two, you're kind of going from one to three. There's not the right path of the upper body in pillar two to three, right? So right here, it just opens a little too much. And when you open around a little too much, you can tend to drop, but you're not really doing that. What you're doing, or what it looks to us, is you see how the left arm now comes wrapping, it goes with the whole body into the throw. It's got to get to a point of holding, but it's folding back. And now you're gonna see that what happens is both arms, boom, boom, right? Arms are back, both arms are like this. So now her body's gonna be shifting. Because the arm starts to go, look at how much circle she's eating up, right? She should be landing in this range, in this general range, right? There's always some forgiveness, but generally we wanna be landing in the center of the circle. That would be our pillar four. Well, she's going too linear and across the circle. So then she's gonna have to rotate herself in a position. And again, now we're seeing that overactive upper body that we started out of our pillar two to three. Now we're seeing it as she goes four, five, it's way too open. It folded, it's pulling her around. So she's not gonna be able to get that big, big sling that you wanna get. Still a pretty nice position, right? I mean, she's able to get good stretch. She's trying to hit that block, so she intuitively kind of does that well. And so, but you're gonna see how, like, the hips are here, the spine line, right? We're gonna look at it. So you're gonna see that she's got her spine here. And what we would wanna see is kind of this. And if anything, we would wanna see the spine a little bit more this way to extend the radius of the discus out to here. But she's pulling herself a little short, right? Now that's because the upper body's too active, it pulls around, it's pulling her off of position, and now she's gonna have to kind of slap it. But again, I like where this is, I like a lot of the stuff, but this is just something to think, and again, this is a perfect example. Chain reaction, we wanna look, what we gotta do is clean up that start. The start is a little too, like I always tell people, if you get low, it's hard to get lower. If you're a little taller, it's easier to kind of drop, right? Hopefully that kind of gives you some insights as well. Okay, next up, Nick Gardner. What we're gonna do is when we kind of look here, again, I like a lot of things Nick's doing. Again, I'm gonna assume Nick has some solid coaching, because I like the way, you know, he's got too much good stuff going on. So what we're gonna say is I like this. I like the way he's lengthening into the throw. I'm gonna cover a couple of quick things. Again, starts generally pretty good. I like the way he's trying to get, he's really nice and long. He's got a nice high point. Couple little subtle things here. He kind of cups the discus a little. That wouldn't seem like a big deal, but that actually can have an influence on your throw. Now, world-class guys that had some funky hand carries, the majority, however, don't. But there is a little bit of this cupping action. I would play with that. That's one of those subtle things that people are looking at, and you go, you don't think it's a big deal, but in the discus, it's massive, right? It's kind of like holding the shot wrong. It's same thing. If you don't get that discus in the right spot, it can cost you a lot of distance. Now, it gets a nice high point, but you see how that discus kind of turns over And then, you know, he does manage to straighten it out. So like I said, there's some people who can throw really far like that, but the majority don't. And I think at early in the stage of your career, if you can get that more efficient, I think it's a bigger advantage. Again, noticing Nick here, I like the way he kind of sets. Now to me, his hips are a little far back and the sweep leg lags a little. Even though he's pushing, you can see that he's actively trying to get the sweep leg into a long path. And he does that fairly well. But what you're gonna see how it kind of, it's more straight. And then he comes here and it kind of comes, he's kind of coming up and down. Now there's one of my all-time favorite throwers, Lars Riedel, kind of came out and hit his sweep leg from what we would call pillar 3 to 4. But again, very different in the sweep leg path here. So that's gonna be something. So the crease of the hip here kind of moves a touch, not bad. You see how you kind of sit again. And when we look at this side angle, you're gonna see how he kind of sits down. He's got a pretty good motion, but there's a little bit. See how the hips are just a touch back? We'd want to see the upper body at this point. We'd want to see that chest back a little bit, and you could control that arm just a touch. Now we're not advocating holding it back. We're advocating long opening on a long path that pulls you into the throw, and it has to open, but it has to open at the right time. It's something we talk about in our system all the time called you have windows where you have to be within certain ranges at each point of the throw. Now, again, overall, I like, you know, he's got a nice looking rhythm. I didn't play it in full speed. I'll do that in a sec. But you can see here, he's moving through the throw pretty well, opens up, but you can see that block. He comes in, and you can see how I can see his fingers right here. That's a good thing, right? He's smashing that block. So let's look here. You'll see the kind of same thing. He hits that block, and everything stops. It doesn't go past his arm. And see how the shoulder pulls back a touch? We want the chest to be moving forward, so we're moving forward like this into the throw. Really, really important. So I would say Nick's doing a lot of good stuff. I would say the movement's very good, and as you continue to keep training and getting better, your re-wrap looks pretty good. That angle of the discus you can kind of see here. And so right here, nice position, and I like the block, but you see how you kind of pull back just a touch, and I know you're non-reversing, but if we were to look at somebody like Robert Harding, you would see Robert Harding like smashing it, and you would see that side come in here, and you've got just a little bit of that as you pull. So just, I would say, one of those subtle tips, try to work your hips through a little bit, bring yourself into the block a little bit more so you don't feel that shoulder back here, you feel it staying here. You're stopping it really well, but it pulls back just a little as you stop it and work around it out into the throw. All right, Nick, because I think you're doing a lot of really good stuff. Last video we're gonna do for the day. So here we have Clay, and again, let's play Clay full speed. You're gonna see, there's some good stuff, and you see there's a little bit of a hesitation. He kind of throws with the thing in the air, and I thought this would be another good example for you guys. Now, one, you kind of come in here. This is subtle. Now, I've had athletes over the years, sometimes I have them carry the discus lower because they don't have the proper special strength to hold the discus in the right orbit, so they don't create the right type of separation and drag. But generally, I would say Clay looks kind of wiry. So I'm gonna have Clay try to focus on carrying that discus a little higher and try to bring it up a touch and see how it's basically gonna be out directly from the shoulder. Now, one of the things here is we go to our pillar two. When you see the head turning like this, this is usually an indicator that shoulders are not in the right position. So you're starting to fall, and that's where your head's gonna go, because it's gonna be trying to catch some balance. So it's a subtle thing. It's not bad, and I like the angle, but you're gonna notice this. You see how the sweep leg's not bad, but see how it's kind of dragging. And then notice how it goes really in. So he's trying to go active, but you see how we have this kind of angle, and we need that angle to be out here, right? So we want it to look more like this. And so we would see that dorsiflexion, right? We would see the foot kind of turned out. Now we don't need to pull it this way. We want it externally rotated. If we're in the right kicking path, the sweep foot is gonna naturally dorsiflex based on the right chain reaction. So sometimes when I don't personally, when somebody is being coached to just dorsiflex, this would be an example of when you might use that cue, because he's pushing in the knee, so you would be, that would be an overcorrection cue. At this point, we're gonna talk about that sweep. One of the key cues we'll use is keep it out and lead with the inside of the knee. And that will kind of help with that dorsiflexion position. Now, he's got a nice linear sprint. I like this. But what you're gonna see is, because of that sweep leg, you see how we have a back in. The sweep leg isn't coming around like this to the middle. The sweep leg is coming around cutting and cutting, right? So that's how you're seeing. So you're not seeing that big, long radius, if you will, even with the sweep leg, right? You want it coming around. So he does the back in. When you do the back in, you get this appearance of separation, but you've kind of turned your hips, and so the separation isn't the hips moving as a unit. So you, because how you know that's the case is, see how the left leg is trailing behind. The foot's on the ground and the left is there, instead of the left being almost, you should, at this point it should be with the knee or slightly behind the knee, moving into the direction of what we would call the power position, pillar five. And so when he's here, this creates a little bit of a shift. So the back end tends to create shift. Now, what saves him a touch is he really tries to load, which is kind of a good intuitive thing. So he winds up in a decent position, but the upper body's too open, right? He's already starting to throw, and you can see that. So now he pulls that. See how he's like, he's double stretched. There's a right way to have some double stretch, where you'd have some bend in the elbow, and then there's this double stretch here. So that's gonna pull him around. And as you're gonna see here, he keeps pulling around. See how it's pulling all the way around, and he's completely off the ground. And that's why you could see that. And he's kind of got that. See how he's literally, he's still got the discus coming off his fingers. Both feet are way up in the air. So that's what gives him that kind of jump thing. Here's the key thing. Like I said, I think he's doing, this is a perfect example. He's doing a lot of good things. He's wiry, he's got a nice feel, because he still smacks the discus pretty nicely. But he's losing that contact with the ground. When you try to throw in the air, it's just not gonna go as far. If he was on the ground and pulling, this would be considerably a further throw. And again, for all I know, his coach could be working on this. This is the one thing I always say when I'm looking at these videos, haven't worked with any of you guys. I don't know any of your habits, strength levels, how you train, your levels of frustration, all that stuff impacts how you throw, but these are just the mechanical things. What I would say is, you definitely wanna be working on this sweep leg path. And the arm is pretty good. I mean, the upper body would be good, but that lower body path is really, I think, what's causing the problem. And again, you notice one of the first things we talked about was that orbit high point. So you notice here, he's got that discus. It's not the worst position, but if it was a little higher, that would help him probably stay on the ball of the delivery foot and rotate around the axis and stay on the ground. But because he's backing in, he's shifting, and he's pulling into the throw. When we do these analysis, you know, if, like I said, not that these were not done to try to plug video analysis, this is just letting you know, these are quick insights. When we do that, we usually request two camera angles, we go through and we break down and we do much more in-depth comparisons, but this is fast, and I know you guys wanna see yourself and other people and different things like that. So we're just trying to give you those kind of high level insights, tie a little bit to our six pillars and see what we would be looking on and how we'd approach fixing it. But this is a perfect example. Sometimes I've seen situations like this, people want to work on the finish, but the start to the middle is really the problem. And ultimately, remember, that's what we're trying to do with the throwing chain reaction system, is teach you guys cause and effect. That's the big thing you want to learn. That's how you're going to get better fast. That's how we've been consistently for going on. Started our 10 year anniversary is next month. This is how we've been able to get consistent results fast, is because we're looking at those cause and effect variables. We're going to pick some more videos for you guys who submitted. So thanks so much for watching. If you like this and you want to see more, be sure to tag us, DM us your video. If you want to get creative, a couple things, send us your PR, your distance that's in the video. If you want to send us two camera angles, send it. That helps you jump out. Those will be some key things, and we will select some people each week. So thanks so much for watching, and we will see you guys on the next video.